Hi, I'm Liz Henry. I work for Mozilla, and they hired me to be the bug master, which I like to say a little bit lower than my normal voice because it makes me think of the movie The Beastmaster, where you're like running around waving your swords and you have all the animals at your command. So that's my little mental picture of what I do in my job. Andre.
And I'm Andre Klapper. I'm, a bug wrangler, which is basically the same, just that Wikimedia Foundation, who I work for, calls it a bit differently.
When did you start at Wikimedia? I forgot.
Like 8 months ago, maybe?
Yeah, I started at Mozilla as the bug master 6 months ago, I would say, approximately. Mm-hmm. And so it's a kind of new role and new position. So we want to talk about basically bug mastering. Oh, that was our intro. Sorry, we have little slides. And you also have done much bug squad things for GNOME, right?
I've been involved with GNOME for years, and basically that's where my open source and free software background is, yeah.
Okay. So what we had planned to talk about, just so you know, if you want to leave the room, totally fine. We want to talk about bug tracker, like the background of bug trackers and the philosophy of what are we doing with this huge database of bugs. Bug triage methods, controversies, painful controversies sometimes of dealing with bugs and bug tracking tools. We'll throw in some best practices tips and then some lists of resources for you. And so we wanted to start with the idea that this is a somewhat new or emerging role in open source projects. Do you want to say anything? I don't want to take all the time. We can switch off.
we haven't cleared before who takes which slides.
Yeah.
So, yeah. it's a bit emerging, relatively new. Though there's Luis Villa, who probably was one of the first bug masters ever for Ximian, if somebody remembers these days. They were bought by Novell. who wrote a paper in 2005, which is called Why Everybody Needs a Bug Master. And the link is also on the last slide, which is probably the first reference or the canonical reference to all this topic. So there's quite some projects who get lots of bug reports and enhancement requests. And to take a bit off the burden for developers and project managers, there's people that triage, which means taking a look at these reports and bringing them into a state that they're useful. And as I probably already said, there's a few active projects with long histories and quite a few bugs, especially Mozilla.
So one thing we were talking about as we planned this talk was realizing that, of course, there are probably huge bug trackers of proprietary software that we don't know a huge amount about unless you work for the particular place. And I don't think that there's necessarily been a role for an overall person to look at the whole picture of what is happening with our bugs within a company or a project, because within a company you might have different actual products or projects, and they had managers who back in the old days when projects had managers. Who were probably responsible for assigning who would work on a bug. So in the open source world, it's more like, what bug do you feel like is the most important, and which one do you have an interest in fixing? So even though Luis Villa says everyone should have a bug master, I thought we could just bring up the question that maybe your project needs a bug master or bug masters, and maybe it doesn't. And we don't really know, because it's kind of a new role and we're still seeing what use it has and what good it can do. Do you really want one person, sort of like a master wiki gardener, to cultivate things? Do you want to encourage it more as a team or group developer activity that's part of their normal workflow? Do you want community triagers, or do you not want community triagers? Seems to be a minor point of controversy. And how will we know if what we're doing is actually useful or not? No one has really made up metrics. I felt very relieved personally that I came into the job and nobody went, there's this many bugs and your job is to make it less bugs. Or no one went, we want you to have 50 community triagers by the end of the month. Like, nobody said that. And partly because maybe no one had thought about it, but also because people have figured out that that kind of metrics doesn't really necessarily mean a lot. We wanted to just mention briefly that we both are going to talk about Bugzilla a bunch, but there are, of course, many bug tracking tools. There is a humongous page if you're thinking about bug tracking for your project. Then there is a giant Wikipedia page called Comparison of Issue Tracking Systems. And it's an amazing page and scary page, but there it is.
So just to give you an idea, what is the size of the bug trackers and how many bugs are incoming? So the Wikimedia one is pretty small, and we only have 10,000 tickets open. These are both bugs
only
and enhancement.
Only 10,000 open bugs. It's like, oh, really? Only 10,000?
This is really handable.
Yeah, one person can totally triage all those.
Yeah, it takes a while to go through all of them and read it, but it's doable. And while GNOME has, of course, way more projects, third-party projects, we're totally independent, I think, currently. In the Git repository, there's probably about 650 projects, and one-third of them pretty dead. But that explains why the number is way bigger. And Mozilla is the most active one, and whenever I take a look at the Mozilla Bugzilla, I also realize that they really use it for everything, even for decommissioning servers or so. That probably also explains why there's so large amounts of bug reports. And when you see, when you take a look at the incoming bug report numbers, then Mozilla has 450 new reports a day, which probably needs quite some manpower if somebody manages to take a look at them. If. And Wikimedia and GNOME are quite handable, I think, still, even if you're only a few people. So, yeah.
That's the overview, just to give you an idea of the activity. This is just to illustrate that. If there are shared searches. This is just like a little tip of using Bugzilla, and I'm sure other bug trackers have similar things, where you can make a search and you can share it for other people. This one is a commonly used one that I want to make new for anyone coming into bugzilla.mozilla.org, that you, as you sign up for an account, you will see it. You will have a link to like the bugs file today. So that's just to pull people in and show them what the activity, what's going on. And this is an example of what that looks like. And it can be really instructive just to see where the most activity is happening. Some of it is service requests, as you say, or little website bugs and things like that, but a lot of it is just like Firefox, 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 like people noticing things. A lot of them are support requests, so what kind of triage we're doing is sometimes just marking things invalid or gently referring people to existing pages. They might be duplicate bugs or support requests or just completely undecipherable. Bugs can be healthy. Like, it isn't bad to say we have a huge bug database. Like, it, so to some people, that might be obvious, but other people think, my God, you have 500,000 bugs. You must have horrible software. But actually, it means you have a healthy and active project that people care about.
At least that's both our opinion. You are free to disagree.
Actually, I'm surprised at how many people find their way through the gauntlet of even creating a Bugzilla account.
Yes.
And getting that far. And a lot of times, like, it shows just how much they care and want to get involved in the first place.
I completely agree. I mean, we're trying to make it easier, but yes.
It takes some efforts, at least creating the account, even if it's only a minute or so. You could maybe even consider it sometimes useful, because that means that you probably get way less support questions and stuff like this, or rants even, because people first have to create an account. So there's, as usual, both sides of the story.
Rather than making it obstructionist and difficult to sign up, though, although that's sometimes tempting, I think as a philosophy, people are trying to make it easier to sign in. But as you sign in, funnel you off. Like, are you unhappy with Firefox? Or, like, do you just want to rant? Or do you feel, you know, do you have a support question? Do you have a feature request? Here are the places to do that, not here. So that's an attempt. So yes, sometimes new bugs mean you have users who care, which is nice. It doesn't mean the project especially buggy, and having no bugs would be a bad thing. It would be a sign of a dead project. What if you have a whole lot of bugs and nobody to fix them? I don't know.
It happens. I'm of the opinion that open bug reports are not a technical debt. So this is the number of open tickets for or that we in general have in the Wikimedia Bugzilla. The green line are those in the status new, which are most of them. And you see, yeah, it's pretty steep. But I don't consider it a problem. And that's, again, probably something that can be discussed or seen differently. But I prefer if bugs get actually filed, and mostly enhancement requests. And for enhancement requests, it's often that they influence this number a lot.
Interesting. So then we wanted to just briefly mention, like, we have to think about as bug wranglers or bug masters, who are we dealing with? We have people in sort of different roles, and we have to talk to all of them. Bug reporters, we were discussing earlier. Module maintainers, like people who are responsible for a specific area of software. The developers who are like often fixing these bugs or who have written the software in the first place. Triagers, who actually do exist already, but who we're trying to make more of. bug tracker, like the admins, like a Bugzilla admin or whoever's the person who has admin rights on the tracker. People who want the data, which often includes people who are managers or execs. For a project, they want all your data, and you have to think about ways to give them the data in graceful ways so that they don't pound you with scrapers.
Or even researchers, yeah.
Researchers, yes. And yeah, so my point there was that thinking about people in those different roles is useful because we have to think about how to interact with each one and what they need. And then about bug triage, we're actually trying to outline what bug triage means and what a triager would do. And different people mean different things by triage. Sometimes they mean bugs that we know are totally valid and things that we need to fix, and they're probably reported, in fact, by us, the developers, working on this thing. And we just, by triage, we mean going through and assigning them people and priorities. And that's sort of what I think of as end stage triage. That sounds dire and medical, but like near the end of the bug life cycle, like it's already a good bug, and people in a team are already going to decide, and I don't need to do anything as the bug master to other than give them tools that will be helpful. Like, I don't need to go do anything. But things that happen earlier in the bug life cycle from bugs that come in from the wild is the field that I think that I feel that I was hired for. Like, the things internal to a team I don't have to touch. And it's to add good information to bugs to make them like well-formed bugs, get the bugs to move around. Not always the hugest priority. I think it would be a mistake to think that our goal is to close the bug. But what their goal is to find the bugs that might be super important or affect things or make things crash and get them into, move them along faster than the other bugs that we actually don't mind if they hang around for a while. We want to be welcoming to bug reporters, help the developers instead of annoying them. And possibly work with the developer teams. I actually think that there is a case to be made, especially at Mozilla, to have designated like triagers or contact point, you know, contacts for triaging within different teams.
I do 7 hours of triage a week for Mozilla.
Do you?
As part of the Firefox OS team.
Wait, who are you?
Dietrich.
Oh, hi.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah,
no, I see you online. On IRC, I'm Lizard. I probably should have said that.
Right.
Okay, so.
But yeah, that point that you made about like that first contact and being welcoming, so many of the engineers don't really, because I was a Firefox engineer for a long time, when you're so deep in a specific area of code and somebody asks a stupid question and a bug, you're like, okay, like it's really important. Like they'll continue to contribute if you can guide them the right way, but it only takes one bad experience to make sure they never come back. And we had a big problem for a while where we realized that people didn't realize that they were coming off negative or difficult or unwelcoming.
Mm-hmm.
Until you pointed them out, took them kind of out of the context, and you pointed them at their own bug comments. And it was amazing to see somebody's reaction that, I can see now how that would not be very nice.
I don't have a screenshot now, but we have that thing that pops up that if you have a Bugzilla account now, you see the little flag that says new to Bugzilla
right next
to a person's name that reports the bug or that comments,
cool.
So you know to be a little nicer to them. Like,
yeah.
Not that you're going to be mean to other people,
like
but you gently...
Hint.
Yeah, context.
Yeah.
I still need to check if that's upstream, I don't know, or if that's a BMO extension, I don't know. But of course I agree. Another aspect of coming across as unfriendly is not explaining your actions. I'm not even referring to high-level decisions on the bug itself, like whether design is good or not, or request, but more like when I close a bug as a duplicate, just to explain, filing a duplicate is nothing bad. And still thanks for... reporting this, but I'm closing it, so everything else is now going on in the other ticket.
So for that, you have like a nice Grease Monkey extension?
I have a small extension for this, which is a Grease Monkey script, mm-hmm. which runs client-side, so in my browser, which gives me one-click stock answers for exactly these cases. And you can get this into upstream, but the extension is not in a state that it could be deployed. And when I grow up and become a hacker, I might be able to make it an upstream extension. I don't know.
Well, we're also working on like a one for bugzilla.mozilla.org that's canned comments. So it's a little Bugzilla extension. But also, again, the issue is, can we get it into upstream Bugzilla? We'll see. I don't know. Right. Oh, this was The Art of Bug Reporting. This was a lovely cartoon by Andy Glover, who has a great blog of little cartoons about software testing and bugs and things. And I like this because it explains kind of what a good bug is and a lot of what I think the early life bug lifecycle triaging and bug mastering, if we make it a verb, which is a little weird and twee sounding, but I'm saying bug mastering or bug wrangling, is that you're basically doing these things. If the bug reporter didn't put them in, you're either encouraging and helping that person, if they want to provide all this detail, or you're providing it. This is kind of also that slide, as we're doing early incoming bug sorting to sort them into places where they might go. In other words, places where the right people might pay attention to them. And in my universe, I don't know about yours, that means figuring out whether it goes in Firefox general or core
finding the right basket,
layout,
yeah.
Or it's actually quite hard to tell where a bug goes until you have learned a fair amount about the geography of an open source project. So part of what I'm pitching as like triage for the community, like come be a bug master with us, is you will learn a lot by doing this about the landscape of this open source project, and then you will learn. It will be a good pathway for you to then learn how to contribute in other ways. Like you might go into QA, you might be a developer, you might start writing automated tests, things like that. Catching crash bugs is a big one. That's very useful when people can do that. It ends up being really satisfying. Adding relevant tags, like adding an accessibility tag or whatever, access tag to an accessibility bug that was reported without anything that would be a keyword for accessibility. Sorting things in the correct product and component for Bugzilla, that's just like the terminology used to describe the project. Regression testing is good and useful for developers. If a bug is otherwise valid, then it's worth it to do that. And if the bug is not valid, why would you care? Do you do that level of work on a bug?
Like regression testing?
Mm-hmm.
We have some automated tests, but we don't have a setup yet that it would create automatically a ticket or something. Not yet, but yeah. Working on it.
No, we don't. It's not that automated. It's just like some Python that you can run that opens up a browser, and then you can test the thing in it.
Oh yeah, we have that.
Okay. Yeah, no, not maybe I didn't describe it.
I'm too Bugzilla oriented,
So that kind of lays out the landscape of what we're talking about and how we're thinking about these things. And then we wanted to go into some of the thornier problems that we've run into. And what we found is that it's very hard to come up with best practices for bug master activities. And part of that is because these issues are incredibly complicated and quite a lot of people depend on them. And so we're describing that with some optimism as best practices are still emerging. Yeah. Here are some of the complicated issues that we wanted to do. And we had thought maybe originally of arguing and taking sides, but I'm not sure if we'll actually achieve this debate format. Just to list them quickly, what the bug life cycle should be, what the workflow of like a bug is in one state and you change it to another state. So that's, I have flags there. That's wrong. It's not flags. It's statuses. Old bugs, should you keep them or should you close them? Do you keep them around for history and for searchability and in case someone else has the same problem or because someone else might fix it? Or do you close them because they're cluttering everything up and distracting? What if you set up your whole bug tracker project and then people just start using GitHub anyway and put things in the issue queue and you never know? That's a problem, but sometimes works. Version fields, what do you do when you have a bug? Can you explain this more, because you do it more?
We'll have a slide for it afterwards.
Oh, okay. Version fields, are you indexing your bug database or not? Is it open to be indexed by search engines? Some projects are and some aren't. Mozilla's is. Do you know about GNOME?
Wikimedia is. GNOME, for example, isn't.
Is not.
Is so, not.
So to go and search bugs in GNOME, you have to go into the bug database, the bug tracker, and search with their tools, which, yeah. Voting. If you let people vote on a bug, does it help or does it hurt? What does it do? And then people's feelings. People's feelings are complicated, and all the people doing stuff in the bug tracker are people, and we forget that sometimes. These are just some examples of the complicated charts that get thrown around about bug life cycles. I think this one is a bit out of date. Here's another one. Oh my God, bug life cycles.
This is the one we are actually using currently. Ignore the green ones. But this is the green ones are ideas what we're currently considering to change. Because normally I'd say keep it simple and stupid. So you start with getting a new ticket, it gets assigned, at some point gets resolved in some kind of way, like fixed if there's really a code fix, or we say one fix, we don't want that. And optionally people can verify it, the reporter. And just to give an example of what the issues are here, some teams I have would like to have a state which says this bug report is not actionable, it needs more information, and want to have that clearly tagged somehow so they can exclude it from the search results. Some folks want to have a patch available status because it means the bug report gets closer to getting fixed. And also, especially with Wikimedia, we deploy our codes to the servers every week now. And I often have users that reported something, the fix got committed into the code repository, and the user says, but it's still broken on the server. And we say, yeah, it's not been deployed. So just to make things a bit clearer and more transparent to the reporters, that's currently what we're thinking about. So this is what we refer to as a bug life cycle. And you can discuss a lot of things about this,
of course. Oh, you can talk about it very endlessly. And part of why it's controversial is that if you change the life cycle, if you add a status, or you take away a status, or you make changes in terminology, you will be breaking someone else's workflow because there's active systems in use. So at the very beginning of your project, you may want to carefully allow statuses. I don't know.
Think twice how you name things. Yeah.
Yeah.
I would love to rename some statuses to just make them clearer.
Yeah.
Like, and upstream Bugzilla has this, like, assigned is nowadays called in progress, or there's no new anymore, but confirmed. And I'd love to change it, but I would break the queries of lots of people out there and their bookmarks, so I don't dare.
The needs info flag was a life changer for us.
Like, I like the needs info flag.
Know, because there's one thing, like, assign says who one's assigned to, but a lot of times somebody is blocked on input from QA, or number of other people who have their opinions on the bug, like no one knows whose court ball is in, right? Like who's the action blocker is different than who's assigned to it. And that needs info flag? Wow.
So
but that's like a little flag, like a separate little ticky box. Yeah. It's not a status. So it doesn't change people's queries,
right.
Really.
So it's outside, it's a metadata about that bug workflow.
So you recommend
that's
using...
That's interesting. Like a lot of what we're talking about is the bug metadata is really important.
So you recommend using need info explicitly against somebody.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's a flag, and you set it to question mark and their Bugzilla account. And you can have multiple of those.
Oh, I wish I had a slide for this, but I don't want to mess around with actually searching it. But yeah.
I just wanted to share something that we did with Bugzilla on a project and see what you think about it. This business is assigned to me, but I've handed it off to QA or... what we would do then is we would actually transfer to them. The bug would go to get assigned to QA for them to do their work, and then when they were done with it, it was supposed to come back to me, they'd reassign it to me. So whoever was assigned to at the moment was the one whose port was in. Good use or bad use? What do you think?
Did it work? I think there's like, does it work for a team in a particular situation, and then there's sort of, is it scalable to make everybody do it and say that it should be everybody's workflow? And that's where it gets like incredibly thorny. So a lot of the thing I see is the benefit of these complicated system, that the systems that we have, is that you can make up your own use, but then on the other hand, it's a little bit fragile, possibly. So that, and that's one reason why Bugzilla is a bit sluggish to change. You may have noticed. Yeah, so you'll break everybody's queries. You'll break their links, their bookmarks. You may break the API, break the, what their tools or dashboards expect. Or you can mess up a team's process, like they have an exact, you know, they all have different processes. They're not that well documented. As I try to find out what they are, I'm like annoying the developers and taking their time. Sometimes they like it, sometimes they don't.
Yeah. Isn't it possible to, like, if you just wanted to change the name of a particular state, couldn't you change the name but also support the old name so you wouldn't be breaking queries?
Maybe.
At the cost of doing some work?
Technically, probably not, but it's an interesting idea. Yeah.
Maybe. I'm not sure the reasons why that would or wouldn't be a good idea, but I'm just thinking about, yeah, you could try to support stuff in the API or make the URL stay the same while people see a different name. I don't know. Part of it is just like, one I hate is invalid. Like, I don't like to mark a bug invalid because people feel terrible. Like, you're like, oh. And I just mean it's a support question or some other reason that it. Not a bug, yeah. So there's endless discussion of this. I also really like the ready flag as an idea to indicate that something was done with triaging as far as the hypothetical community triagers that sort of exist. if you're done with triaging, then the bug is now in the ready state where it's ready for a developer to work on it. But that didn't quite pan out, and I could try to force it, but I'm not sure that would be worth it. Yeah, statuses. That was what we're just basically discussing, is the subtle problems of statuses. And then another, that should probably have been on a different slide. Do you reopen a closed bug? Do you?
Or file a new bug. I've worked for companies where there was a policy like you can reopen a ticket within 2 weeks, but afterwards file a new ticket because the code base. If it's really like, it's kind of assumed that the code fix actually had an impact or had no impact and didn't fix the bug report. While after a while, at some point, the code base has changed so much that developers would consider, okay, this is a completely new issue, probably because of other changes, and don't reopen the bug because at that time I really fixed it and the fix worked. So there's also a question like if there should be a policy with some teams or where you would put that after how many weeks or months.
Yeah. I think going along with that, people have discussed having systems to archive comments, like there's 100 comments on some bug that's super old, and maybe you don't actually need to see that first. Maybe you want to just see the most recent couple of things and the rest of it isn't relevant. But that's also quite controversial. Or people discuss tagging comments or being able to vote on comments so that you can see the most important comments. That also, what a can of worms. Here's my slide to represent, because I felt we needed a kitten picture in this, was the reactions to when you want to add a ready status or you want to change invalid to be like resolved support or something like that, and everybody freaks out and you have an enormous mailing list thread. Or a huge Bugzilla comment thread.
Bug retention? To close or not to close ancient tickets. So we are undecided. Yeah.
That was my sample.
there's a lot, especially in Mozilla Bugzilla, lots of ancient tickets that haven't been touched for more than 6 or 7 years. And the question is, so how much does this influence the search results? If you have a developer who wants to find a bug report and you get lots of ancient tickets that probably some of them are even not valid anymore, shall you clean up those old tickets or even mass close without trying to reproduce? Because you assume that the crowd out there will file a new bug report if the issue still exists.
Right,
or
like
do you keep it
crowd.
Open? Yeah, do you trust the crowd or do you keep it open and say like, well, that could still happen and theoretically somebody picks it up? And discussing with managers in different companies, I've faced both attitudes. So
I tend to be a little in favor of closing. And in fact, I am going around poking and closing old bugs. And some people are quite annoyed because it sends lots of bug mail. So one of the good Bugzilla tips and the best practices that we're trying to intersperse in with our talk about the problems and difficulties and is that it's good to set up filters. You're going to get bug mail. You're going to get mail from your bug tracker, and so are a lot of other people sometimes.
I more and more get the opinion, actually, that this policy, or whether you close ancient tickets or not, should probably depend on how large your bug tracker is. Because for Mozilla Bugzilla, I think it makes more sense than for a smaller Bugzilla, because I'm simply after keeping the search results clean so developers can find what they want to work on. And with a large bug tracker, you get way more noise, of course. So I think for large bug trackers, I agree.
I have been trying to clear out a little bit of the cruft, because not just for search results and for developers working on things, but for people coming into the project anew, whether they're new triagers, right? Because I want more new triagers, or they're people looking for like a good first bug to fix. I want them to not have something marked good first bug that's actually from 2004 and isn't even really a bug anymore. So doing a little bit of that cleanup and maintenance, I think, has been really useful so far. And I'm only 6 months into the job, so we'll see. But I think it's been fun. The only objections have been, sometimes I make mistakes, like I'm need infoing somebody who isn't even with the project anymore and hasn't been heard of for 4 years and doesn't answer their mail, So things like that can happen. But I think that those mistakes are worth it. Keeping them open, somebody from the community might come along and that's their itch and they might scratch it. So they might feel validated, like, oh, someone else had that little problem with that preference panel 4 years ago and I do too, so maybe I'm going to fix that bug, right?
It's simply hard to get an idea how much this specific code base has changed in the meantime that the bug report is about. You really need to know the code base, and that's probably only like that a developer can do.
Yeah. Well, it won't go anywhere because you close it. It stays there. Like, you could still find it again. So my feeling is it's not like, I tend to be a very passionate anti-deletionist in Wikipedia for things that aren't like spam or horrible. But why delete it? We have room. We can save things. Not because someone's not notable, for example. So bugs that are old are still there, and you could still find them, and you could still find the discussion.
So to quickly summarize, so it's on the record, Your point is probably that it's useful sometimes to reopen tickets that even got closed months ago because there's so much background information in the bug comments, right?
Yeah, so okay. You could probably bug the issue, but if there's all this historical information, that might make it easier to figure out.
Oh, thank you for summarizing what the question was. I forgot that we're recording.
And yeah, we're recording.
Right, to repeat it for the recording. yeah, sometimes old bug information is super useful. Totally agree. On this, actually, I had sort of a meta point here that's another sort of Bugzilla tip or triaging tip, which is, I know that you can't read this very well, but the column headings here are all sortable. And this is something that even people who use Bugzilla for years maybe don't realize sometimes, that you can sort on all these column headings. That can be a really interesting way into triage. And since we're just mostly experimenting and playing around, this is one way I might choose to do something. I'll just look at all the core layout bugs and say, hey, I can sort them by the ID first number first filed, so I can see the oldest bugs or when the bug was created, pretty much the same thing. I can look at when the bug was last changed for some bug that hasn't been changed since 2004. I might want to start there and try triaging them in that way and then see what happens. What happens to those bugs? What kind of motion happens?
And you can change
maybe
the
a
columns.
Mass close, a gentle mass close might be effective, but I haven't tried that yet. That tends to be like warn everyone, need info, a lot of bugs, and see if you get a response, and then go back 2 weeks later and close the ones that haven't had any movement. That could be one technique. Oh, apostasy. Here is I decided to name it something silly. But this is for, say you have a bug tracker like Bugzilla, and then teams go off and use some other issue tracker or project management tool, and then they don't know about each other. So people coming in from the community who want to report a bug don't know whether they should be doing it in a GitHub issue queue or in Bugzilla. Maybe they do it in both. So we create tools that link them up, and they can be visible to each other, but it can be kind of a problem. At least it becomes messy and complicated. It already is messy and complicated, so, but that's an issue to be aware of. Do you have this problem? Do you rule with an iron hand?
In Wikimedia, I was looking at the watch, so we still have like 10 minutes or so.
Okay.
We have this a bit because in Wikimedia teams, development teams have lots of freedom also in choosing which tools they want to use. So. For planning tools, we definitely have a few other ones in place that are used by some specific teams, though everybody looks at least a little bit into Bugzilla.
Yeah, what I see the most is people building dashboards that use the API so that they can then look at their bugs. But that sometimes means fairly clunky solutions like displaying queries inside a wiki page and then just managing it by hand. You know, changing it every week. So more dynamic tools and dashboards, I think, will be necessary as projects evolve. Version flags?
this is another thing. You have a version field, and it's not really clear what it means. So it could mean this bug report affects this specific version of the software. It could also be the first version it was spotted in or so, or found in. I've also seen Bugzillas that have a version field called something like Git Master or CVS Head, which is completely useless if you use this for 10 years. And because Git Master 10 years ago, well, Git didn't exist, but still, you get the point. So I normally, in those projects I'm active in, I normally try to bump the version field to the latest version the bug was found in, because that's more interesting if this bug still recently happened and if somebody should investigate, than if it was found 6 or 9 years ago for the first time. But this is another thing, for example, which can be useful to discuss with other developers or testers.
Yeah. I have no idea how far along our slides is, but our main point here with these problems, I think this was my attempt to summarize problems. All the details matter. Bug trackers are notoriously overcomplicated and people hate them and get upset that they suck, but actually we like them because they're complicated and can do many things. And I have noticed a thing where that I was calling parameter overload. I don't know if this is a real name. I just made it up. But where people go, there's too many whiteboard tags. It doesn't mean anything anymore. So we're going to make a new thing called a thing flag. And you can check the ticky box of the whatever flag, and we'll do something else. So you just end up with a ton of features. That's what makes it so complicated, because it grows organically. And I don't think that necessarily is a problem.
That's exactly where a bug master or bug wrangler job can help a bit. It's like wiki gardening. At some point, you have to categorize a bit and try to keep an overview. And for example, I see this in Mozilla Bugzilla, that there's hundreds of keywords. And if you want to start categorizing things, you cannot memorize all these keywords. So I think somebody should clean up.
I like the idea of cleaning that up. Thanks. You know what I did do recently was I cleaned up saved searches a little bit.
Okay.
So I just realized, there's like 900 saved searches in Bugzilla that are public, and most of them are out of date. But only like 300 people have created those 900 saved searches. So I'll just hand email all those 300 people. Well, not mass email them, but I'll email those 300 people and ask them to delete stuff that isn't relevant that they created. And that happened. And now there's 300 saved searches. That's still too many for a human being to really figure out what's useful to them. So I'm going to build other infrastructure around that. So I see my role also as not just being involved with triage and community building, but also with improving the tools that we have and making changes to Bugzilla that reflect what the community that uses it want. So I'm kind of boldly stepping into, I'm going to meddle in Bugzilla development and direction.
Similarly,
yeah, we're going to conspire, so look out. Hooray, bug wranglers. Like I said before, I see it as a good pathway into open source. That's part of why I've started triaging the good first bugs and the mentored bugs that we have. I just went, oh, look, there's like 600 things tagged good first or mentored bugs, but some of them haven't been touched since 2003. Let's clean that up. And that's been very productive, I think. I think that will be helpful.
And it's definitely a good entrance point for new contributors to the community. I can't judge this yet for Wikimedia, but in GNOME, many now core developers have started as bug triagers, and after a few months moved on, because you triage these bug reports, and at some point for some easier tickets you think, oh well, I could try to fix that, and then you start writing patches, and at some point you become a developer. So there's some fluctuation in the triagers team, but I think it's good because the people still stay in the project and then move on or become developers.
Yeah, that's actually my vision of it at Mozilla too. That's what I've seen, is that the people pointed out to me when I started as good triagers have already been hired in as good as developers or user support people, user advocates, things like that. And here's our useful links. It's not a whole lot of them, but it's things that we mentioned in the talk. There is a Bugmasters channel. There's actually a Bugmasters mailing list, which right now is mostly Mozilla focused, but we are talking about how we might want a cross-project bug manager wrangler list. So that may happen to talk about these things as a role. The Bugzilla Tips blog is great if you actually are working with Bugzilla, since that's what we've been talking about this whole hour. And the why everyone needs a Bugmaster is the reason we have these awesome jobs, right? Thanks, Luis Villa. I think that's the end. Does anyone want to talk about things? Like, why don't you do X in Bugzilla?
Or do you have unsolvable bug management problems and you would like to hear our advice?
Yes.
I just want to mention, so I've... Oh.
Great.
So I've got a number of projects that are just myself. And so mostly, so up to this point, my bug tracker has been in my head. And I've been thinking about, okay, well, all right, what actual software do I want to use to do this? And what I'm thinking of doing and what I've started experimentally doing is actually storing the bugs in the code repository. So just using a simple textual format in a special directory. And so if I, so the bug goes in there, and if I make a change that fixes the bug, then in the same commit that makes that change, I also change the status of the bug from, you know, to fixed.
That's cool. So each project will have its own built-in bug tracker?
Mm-hmm.
That's a cool idea. It should, you know, name that something. I don't know.
So I'm still working on it.
I actually love the GitHub issue tracker. I mean, I actually was, sounded like I was ragging on it, but I didn't mean to rag on it, too.
Well, for me, the GitHub issue tracker is out of the question since it's closed source.
Yes. Always good to mention that.
So what I'm just curious, do you have one list with all of the bugs, one file, or one file per each bug report?
I've just started doing this, and I spent months just figuring out what this directory should be called. It's notes in all caps. So it includes bugs, but it's also just includes ideas and just whatever I'm thinking about that hasn't actually been implemented yet. So I've got notes, and then under that is to-do. And so I've started off just making, okay, here's some things that I haven't done yet, and I want to get them, you know, into storage and out of my head.
That sounds good, and like people could potentially help you that way. They could see what you want worked on.
I was asking because if you're after contributors, you might end up with some discussions on specific bug reports. And if this is all in one file, I'm afraid of conflicts or who's working on what or who's assigned to what.
Oh, no, the idea is to have one file per issue. So, for example, the project I started doing this with is an emulator, 68K emulator, and so I've got one file saying, okay, here are the instructions added in the 68020, which I haven't implemented yet. Here are the ones added in the 030. And here's the, you know, here's the FPU instructions. So they're just different files for like one file per issue, per thought almost. And so yeah, that's the great thing about Git. There's no penalty for having multiple files. In fact, it works better that way.
I forgot I was going to mention the code triage app is an interesting thing.
Do it now.
Do it now, quick. I don't know. So this was something somebody built off the GitHub API. I can't remember who made it, or I would shout them out. But it you can look through everything in GitHub by language or by popularity or different ways to sort, and then you can say, I'm interested in like the Planetaria, you know, code, and then you get an email every day, which is a little much, telling you a random bug that you could go triage. And the email explains to you how to triage the bug and add good information to it. And I thought that was a pretty cool idea. I'm not going to triage a bug every single day for some random project. So usually they just get deleted, and make me feel guilty, which is bad. But it was a quite interesting idea, and I think there could be other ways to encourage people to do this work.
Other comments, questions, input, criticism, rants?
A question for you. One of your slides towards the end talked about having other project management systems with their own bug trackers hosted on you. I've had several of those things shut down my throat. I wonder, do you ever try to federate the Bugzillas together so that you can look at Bugzilla and the managers can look at their weird solution and everyone sees the same report? Or do you do what I eventually did, which just rudely paste a link to Bugzilla and the other thing and decide that if the managers are ever going to view the bug reports, they can just click on the URL and later find out that, no, actually they don't, they just want the reports.
Complicated question about when people use other tools. Do you have like an example of a tool?
All right, so I used to work for the IBM LTC, and we had our own Bugzilla, and then Red Hat has their Bugzilla, and SUSE has their own Bugzilla, so we created this weird bug mirroring system that would try to make it so that you could browse Red Hat bugs and SUSE bugs and IBM bugs in the same.
So you want like a federated Bugzilla or some kind of strange bug transclusion system?
Yeah, except that they chose to do this with the account Bugzilla account of some fellow named Glenn Johnson. So all the comments were from Glenn Johnson.
So you're referring a bit to the upstream downstream basically relation. I guess. I guess right now there's nothing coming to my mind like cross Bugzilla search or inter Bugzilla search or whatever you would call it. I hope a little bit that the RPC interfaces, the web service interfaces of Bugzilla, will improve, so that more in this area is possible and somebody could build way easier a tool on top of this.
Yeah, late in the last year, I've written probably 30 different Bugzilla dashboards using the REST API for Bugzilla, which I don't think...
The REST API is planned for upstreaming for the next version.
Oh, okay.
It's not upstream, the REST API, no.
Yeah.
But I've seen every combination of... We wrote dashboards that combined all of GitHub issues for a bunch of projects with a bunch of Bugzilla tickets, syncing between Jira and Bugzilla, Bugzilla to Bugzilla, and then unknown secret sauce behind proprietary wall in Bugzilla.
Yeah.
In the last year, I've seen all of those combinations, and all of them kind of suck in different ways.
I would love to pick your brains about that a little bit.
So like they're talking about all these labels and tags and fields, and not only that, like all these personal workflows that people have on top of these tracking systems, and I think that's why they don't. None of those map to each other cleanly.
Yeah, see, I thought it was just me who was unlucky and had like seven different Bugzillas for the same code base, but maybe not.
Bugzilla to Bugzilla, you'd think would be a little easier, you know?
I think it's a common problem.
Use Linux kernel mailing list like everybody else.
Especially when you have upstream-downstream relations like with Linux distributions or so on. I think it's a pretty common problem, yeah.
Yeah,
let's wrap that up. Thank you so much.
Thanks.